If you're like me and own a 2019 BT50, but any of the Ford Rangers from 2011 onwards, and the Mazdas, the same thing, they all run a two-piece tail shaft and are very prone to having a driveline vibration, especially once you put a lift in these things. Anyone who says they don't have a driveline vibration is probably lying. And some people can feel it more than others due to the amount of weight that you carry in the vehicle. The heavier the vehicle, the less the differential can actually kick around due to weight. And this is mainly due to the type of spring pack you use, the fact that it's sitting on the overload leaves, which stop the diff being able to wrap as the vibration increases. But what this does is actually transfers the vibration of the tail shaft into the gearbox and starts causing damage, I believe. One of the reasons why the autos crack flex plates in these things. So just something to be mindful. I don't know if it's actually the cause of the crack, but I know when I've worked on converting prime movers through to rigid body trucks and seen what happens when people get driveline angles wrong on those and how it damages gearboxes and engines. This is something that needs to get right when you do have a vehicle with a two-piece tail shaft. Now, the first thing someone's going to say to me is, well, just put a one-piece in there. You could do this if you had a bucket load of money. Now, the overall length of this tail shaft is 1,636 millimetres. That's quite a long tail shaft to make to one piece. Now, I see the Isuzu D-Max runs a one-piece tail shaft, but this is a 4-inch diameter alloy tube shaft, and it is quite expensive to get one of these things made. Now, the longer the tail shaft, the longer the tail shaft, the more it wants to run like a skipping rope. Imagine you and your friend holding a rope at either end and turning it. That's how a tail shaft wants to run the longer it is. So to rectify that problem, you have to have a larger diameter, thinner wall. So the heavier the tail shaft, the more it wants to swing out in an elliptical, in an oval sort of shape in the middle as it swings. So just, as I said, imagine a skipping rope, turning a skipping rope. You've got to get the rigidity there so that actually doesn't shake itself. Thus, while you have a two-piece tail shaft. Now, Ford, being a tight-ass sort of company, has gone, well, bugger it, I believe. Let's make the cheapest possible tail shaft we can possibly put in this thing and see if we can make it work. And that's basically what they've done. They've come up with a standard two-piece tail shaft that from factory has vibrated. And they've done various different things to fix the vibration problem themselves. You can see on some of the earlier models, they had mass dampers to help reduce the vibration. That obviously didn't work. And then in the case of my model and most of them, they actually out of phase the differential universal joint by one spline to help counteract the balance. Now, this actually does work when you're at stock heights. It works within a reason. So the idea is they offset this, which changes the time that the elliptical effect that this U-joint runs in with the rest of the U-joint and joints to try and put it in somewhere near a phase or cancel out a vibration. Now, I approached a couple of tail shaft shops and none of them could explain why would someone put a universal joint out of phase. They say it's pretty common. Some manufacturers like Holden and whatnot used to do it, but they wouldn't build a tail shaft themselves with a U-joint out of phase. Now, if you don't understand what I mean by out of phase, there's lots of YouTube videos on how to phase tail shafts and what it means. So just go check them out and bear with me as I try and explain the rest of this. So this is my vehicle setup after I lifted it 50 mil. We need to talk about a couple of things in tail shafts first, I guess, is working angles of U-joints. That's the angle that the U-joint works at all the time. as it's sitting there in a static sort of measurement. So you climb under the vehicle with a finer angle gauge, you put your finer angle on the bearing, on the universal cap, on the yoke of your gearbox, and then on the top of the tail shaft, and measure the angle. So in my Mazda, it was, the yoke is 3 degrees down, and the tail, the second tail or first tail shaft is 6 degrees down, and you subtract 3 from the 6 to give you this universal joint is working at a 3 degree angle. As we go down, you see the cent is a 50 mil lift. The center bearing universal joint or center universal joint is working at 2 degrees, and you then you have the differential one. It actually is, pinions tilted up 4.7 degrees, but they still call that a downward angle because the angle's still running down. It would be up if it was like upwards angle, if it was like that, but we'll just concentrate on calling this a pinion up, and it's working at 3.3 degrees and with a out of phase U-joint. So once you lift this and you increase your working angles and everything gets out of whack, the more angle you have, the more this is going to vibrate. So less 3 degrees and less, the less elliptical effect the slowing up and the speeding down of a U-joint has. So if you want to learn more about that, there's plenty of videos on how a U-joint travels at speed. So go check them out. So this is what happened with mine. I had a bad vibration. You could drive down the road on a perfectly smooth road and you'd find you're sitting in the car with your belly wobbling and a resonance that comes through the vehicle. With there should be no sort of vibration at all. It's like driving over small corrugations, but only with the back axle is sort of how it felt. There's no sensation in the front wheels or anything, just in the back axle. What's an easy way to tell that if you've actually got a driveline vibration is to actually put the car up on axle stands and actually put a jar of water on the chassis rail or the running boards, and with the car on axle stands, actually run it up to speed and get someone to look at your jar of water and see if there's any vibration. A perfectly smooth tail shaft, there will be no vibrations or movement in this cup of water at all. The other way to tell is to have it up on axle stands, put it in gear with someone sitting in the cab, and sort of climb underneath if you're game and have a look at how much movement is in the center bearing as it's turning over at idle. If this thing's wobbling up and down as it's moving, it means you actually have universal joints that are fighting each other, and that's where your vibration is coming from. Right, so back to the photos. So this is my layout as I described, 8 degrees down on the second tail shaft. Now, originally these things run almost dead straight on my vehicle, pretty close, within, you know, half a degree. So, you know, this would be 6 degrees, this would be, you know, 6.5, 7 degrees sort of thing. So once you lift it, you end up with more working angles and steeper working angles and things. And this, due to this U-joint being out of phase, it causes the vibration. Now, you can simply just phase that U-joint. I went ahead and phased this U-joint the same as this U-joint, and that didn't fix the problem. It still vibrated. Made it a little bit better, but didn't fix it. Even after I did drop the center bearing so it was dead straight, it still vibrated. Now, we've got to move on a little bit further here, and also realize that the center U-joint and the differential U-joint also run at a compound angle. So this is a top view, that was the side view. So top view showing that this actual tail shaft is actually, the differential is offset to the driver's side here in Australia by about 15 millimeters off center. So that means that this U-joint is running at a compound angle. Now there is a formula to work this out so you can work out your overall working angle. I think this angle, when I sat down and worked it out, it was quite a hard thing to do because it requires you running string lines and stuffing around, but it added to about half a degree or 0.7 degree more working angle. So 2 degrees, 2.7, 3 degree roughly compound angle. And obviously you've got to add that into that which brings this up to around about 4 to 4.5 degree working angle because of the compound in it. Okay, that's something to be wary of when you're mucking with tail shaft, is not just the side view angles, but the actual top view and compound angles. This causes actually, you know, a larger operating angle of the U-joint, and the larger the operating angle, the more chance there is to have a driveline vibration. Now, if you go into the Dana Spicer book that I've got, this is actually online. I'll try and put a link in the bottom if I remember. And they'll tell you that, and there's other videos on YouTube, that this first shaft has to be dead straight. It's like an extension of the crankshaft. Run it straight. The U-joint can't run in its elliptical effect because it doesn't have a bend. But Spicer states that you need at least a 1 degree working angle to allow the grease to move in the universal joint, so the needles are lubricated. Otherwise, they tend to wear out premature. So if you were to set your vehicle up with a 50 mil lift, like Spicer says, so 1 degree working angle, so you raise your tail shaft up, so it's 4 degrees down. You're still going to have 3 degrees at your gearbox down. So you get your 1 degree angle, your actual operating angle of your second tail shaft becomes to 12 degrees, which then throws these angles really high, these working angles, 8 degrees and 9 degrees. Now, the reason why this is 9 degrees, I put some caster wedges in here. I'm trying not to work in decimal points because it gets a bit difficult, like it was originally. It's 4.7 degrees pinion tilt up, so we'll just work in single figures. So I put 2 degrees caster wedges in there, gave it about 3 degrees down, thinking that allowing for the pinion to climb under drive. So that's something you've got to be wary of, depending on how your spring packs are and how much wrap you've got in your spring packs. You can easily work this out by getting someone to watch as you put the vehicle in gear and then put your foot on the brake and then stall it out and see how much the pinion tilts. You can put an angle gauge on it as you do it on the tail shaft to see if it actually tilts up, or the actual differential housing, I should say, and watch what it does, and then sort of work out a halfway figure in between there of what pinion climb that you have. So that's something to be sort of wary of. As you're driving down the road under load, the pinion's going to tilt up. And they always say you should tilt it about 1 degree down. So that's why this one's got a 9 degree working angle at a static. But as it tilts up, the theory was it should come up to that 8 degree operating angle. So this should tilt up to 4 degrees, hopefully. But anyway, so I actually tried this. I actually cut the center bearing mount, raised it up. So the first tail shaft was at 4 degrees. And thinking, because I've run universal joints at steeper angles than this, this actually did run smooth, but it had the world's worst launch shutter. It felt like you were bloody hopping ties when you went to take off the lights, even at a gentle acceleration. It was rubbish. So don't go, that didn't work. But if you read a bit further in the Dana Spicer book, it tells you another option. But first thing I needed to do is talk about the center bearing. The center bearing itself is utter rubbish. It's really sloppy and doesn't help whatsoever, being so sloppy, to support the tail shaft very well. So once it starts to resonate, it can keep resonating. So that's the center bearing. That's what it looks like. This is the actually correct orientation. So this is my drawing of that. Is the mounting tags are offset, so you want to have it so the tag, this is the right way down, the offset is towards the bottom and up that way, so you've actually got the least amount of angle on that. If you were to turn that around so it's the tags at the top, you'll drop your tail shaft. Now, some people have done that, and some of the factory setups I've seen have been dropped like that. So they drop the first tail shaft and then try and run the bottom one straight. That works too. I've seen trucks that are done like that, but it's probably not the ideal way to sort of deal with it from, you know, my point of view anyway. So just make sure your center bearing is this way around in the vehicle. That might help, showing you like that. Okay, that's with the spacer kit in there. So you, what are you going to do to get rid of this vibration? And there's a couple of ways you can go. The cheapest way is to go buy yourself a spacer kit to space your tail shaft down. Now, most of the instructions keep saying, most instructions of these spacer kits say, keep dropping the tail shaft until your vibration's gone. Wow, big lot of help that is. So what I can tell you from what I've learned, and bag me out or whatever you want if I'm wrong, but anyway, is you need to drop your tail shaft, so your center bearing, so the tail shafts are running at exactly the same angle. So if this is 7 degrees down, that's 7 degrees down, right? And that's to reduce the operating angle of this U-joint. You got to remember it's got a compound angle. So, you know, you want to have it less than 1 degree, ideally 0.5 of a degree or next to zero difference. So say you had 7 degrees here and you had 6.5 or 6.7, that's probably okay, right? But you want to try and space that to be correct. The other thing you're going to have to do is make sure that your pinion angle is correct. If you've got 3 degrees down on here, right, you need 2 to 3 degrees pinion tilt here. So it might require you putting caster wedges in there to get your caster wedge right, okay? If it's at 4 degrees, it's going to be no good, right? So just a matter of measuring your angle of your tail shaft, working out your working angle here, and you want the same sort of working angle here. You want 4 to 3 degrees working angle, depending on how much your pinion climbs under load, okay? So it'll be pretty safe if you're at, you know, if you had 2.5 degrees pinion angle, 2.7, that sort of thing. Even at 3, it's probably okay, because also you got to allow for coast. This pinion will climb down under coast too, so you're trying to get that average of the two. And as I said again, it depends on the design of your spring pack, how much your diff can wrap around under load. All right, so if you've got a constant load and you don't, you know, the vehicle has the same load on it all the time, this will work fine, okay? This will give you the most or the least amount of vibration for bang for buck. So dropping your tail shaft with a spacer kit, getting your tail shafts running at the same angle down, and then rephasing, this is the important part, rephasing this differential U-joint to be in the same phase as a gearbox U-joint. So what you're actually doing is treating this as a one-piece shaft, right? So without any angle on this, you don't have a phasing or elliptical effect of this U-joint, so you don't have to cancel out its phasing at all. It's still going to have a slight, you know, if you look underneath and run this and have a look at the center bearing, it's still going to have a slight wobble because you do have that compound angle. And that's why I said 1 degree or less operating angle, you know, if you want to work at it. So that's just side view angle, you know, and we can forget about the compound angle if we're running it closest to 0 degrees bend whatsoever in that tail shaft. Sometimes it takes a bit of a muck around. You might have to find that, you know, because the car squats a bit down the load road, you might have to run it at 1 degree to get rid of the vibration. That's going to be up to you. But if you start off with this, it'll give you a fairly good running tail shaft. So you're going to, getting back to rephasing it means that if this bearing cap here of the universal joint is showing to you, the bearing cap here of this universal joint should be showing to you at the gearbox on the side from a side view, okay? And that puts this universal joint in phase with this, where originally it's sort of not in phase with anything, but more in phase with these two joints here, like you would have in this setup here. So this is where it's phasing. This is U-joint is actually physically not there. Now, if you actually didn't have a U-joint here, you wouldn't have to space the tail shaft. And that's what I ended up doing. Because I tow trailers and very load in the back of the vehicle, I had to come up with something that would work that wasn't over the top price-wise. And the best alternative I could come up with, and I had to work all this out myself because none of the driveline shops will help you or anything like that, is end up putting a 1350 double cardine joint. These all run 1350 joints. Getting them to weld a 1350 cardine joint to the first tail shaft and then phasing the second tail shaft universal joints the same, right? So no outer phase at all. And contrary to popular belief that you can't phase it because there's a master spline, that's a load of shit. I've got two tail shafts and both of them have been able to be rephased quite easily without having to cut the yokes off. It's just a matter of sliding the slip joint out and moving it one spline on one tail shaft. The other one I had to rotate at 180 degrees to get it perfectly right. Yes, if you do that, you will have to get them rebalanced if you feel like it. So with this setup, if you go through this and turn the tail shaft, so you're basically turning this 90 degrees to where it was to get it in the right phasing. Right, so that will affect your balance, but very marginal because you're actually just moving it at the slip joint. It won't be that far out of whack. But if you run it like that and feel like you need to get it rebalanced like that, by all means, get it rebalanced like that. All right, so to get this double cardine joint cost me, welded in, tail shaft balance cost me $700 from the tail shaft shop. Plus purchasing, I purchased a second tail shaft from the wreckers for about $250, which was done like 45,000 Ks. So that made it quite, you know, say $1,000 all up, I guess, to get this modification done. It made it worthwhile. So this tail shaft now runs without any vibration whatsoever. These are the angles on it. So we've still got 3 degrees down at the gearbox because I can't change the angle of the engine or anything like that. 6 degrees down on the tail shaft, so there's no center bearing spaces. It's just back to the standard height with the center bearing sitting like it does with the offset tags, so it's actually pushed up as high as possible and no spaces in the thing. Well, you won't need spaces, I do, because some idiot cut his mounts to try and get it to work, but that's part of the process of learning, isn't it? Then rephasing the tail shaft here, so these are both in the same phase, and these are the angles that the tail shaft now runs at. 6 degrees down, 3 degrees, so we've still got a 3 degree working angle here. Now we have 9 degrees here, so 9 subtract 6 works out to a 3 degree working angle. And then I put 1 degree caster wedges with the thickest part of the caster wedge in the towards the front, so the pinion tilted up to match the angles, right? So 3.3 degrees, 5.7 in the scheme of things. So that is, yes, is not 100% correct, but because I've tried it at 4.7, and it vibrated a little, probably worse on coast, because the actual diff actually drops down more on coast on my vehicle due to the design of the spring packs, rather than it tilts. So, you know, 3.3 to 3 degrees, it's not going to care. 1 degree difference between these two angles isn't going to affect it, according to what Spicer says in their literature. So that is how mine now runs, and I believe it to be, as I said, it runs vibration free. So there's a picture of the double cardine joint in the vehicle, so to give you an idea of what they look like. Now, some tail shaft manufacturers will probably tell you that it's probably too heavy. And if that's a concern for you, it hasn't given me any issues so far. The gearbox, transfer case bearing, I should say, doesn't feel like it's wearing any faster or anything like that. You could actually put a repeza or a constant velocity joint here and fix the problem too. It's just more expensive. They're a more expensive way because you've got to change your companion flange. Now, the front tail shaft runs a CB joint, so you could possibly get a front companion flange off out of the front output companion flange off the transfer case and a front tail shaft and brutalize that to make it work for your needs too. So that's another option I looked at. Obviously, the CB joint is a lot smaller and not as strong as this. But if you go to the Ranger Raptor that we have here in Australia with a 2-litre bi-turbo engine, it actually runs a CV joint in the middle, a constant velocity joint in the middle. So the repeza joint in the middle, I think it's how you say it. And what you do then, if you were to do that, is to phase this, and this few joints the same way, like I have done with the center bearing drop I was talking to you about, was basically that takes away any velocity changes, because it's got a constant velocity joint, and that's what they've done in the Ranger Raptor, which I think is a better setup. But you know, this is said, like Ford wanted to go about the cheapest way possible on actually making the tail shaft work in these cars. So that should cover everything. The only other thing that I've done is on the center bearing, I've actually inserted a nylon ring to support the center bearing a lot better, because this thing is extra sloppy. They're rubbish. I haven't come across a center bearing that's so badly supported. Even in the Ranger Raptor with the constant velocity joint, they run a double-sided supported center bearing. So it's got it doesn't have an open face. This face is towards the rear. So this is about a 25 mil thick bit of nylon that I pressed into there. So I can't remember the measurements, sorry, but I measured the outside diameter, this diameter, large diameter here, and the inside diameter against the castellations, and got it made up and machined up and pressed it in. You can get a piece of nylon, cut it with a jigsaw, and do the same thing. All I've done is I've drilled and tapped through the actual center bearing housing and into the nylon here, and used in four places to hold it in spot in place, and this has worked fine. Now, people talk about gluing it. Unless you use quite a flexible glue, the gearbox does kick around a fair bit under load. And I believe that if you made it too rigid, it'll probably put too much loading on that bearing and probably maybe cause premature wear. Not sure, but my theory was to allow it to still move around. And now the vehicle runs without a driveline vibration. It's smooth as. Right, I'm going to go out in the shed now and show you what I meant by rephasing the tail shaft and show you how it's possible. Out in the shed with my spare tail shaft, and as promised, I'm going to try and show you how to set up the tail shaft for just a center bearing drop, so you can have an idea of how to reorientate the slip joint to get everything phased correctly, and to show you that it's actually possible to actually get this slip joint to sit in the right position so things are actually correctly phased. Now, I've read a lot about it, and people say there's a master spline and all that sort of stuff. That's all shit. I've pulled two shafts apart, and there is no master spline that's going to affect how you actually put these shafts together, okay? So as you can see on the thing, there's a Ford sticker that comes on. It's a Dana part number tail shaft. You can see they've got weights on them. They're balanced pretty well from factory, kind of. And as you can see here, I've got the gearbox end up this end here to my right, and center bearing, center uni, slip joint, and the differential end. Now, as you can see, that I've got the bearing cap just sitting here on the steel to keep it level. This bearing cap is sitting on top of the steel on the other side, the universal cap, I should say, on the weld yoke. Come down here, you can see these two unis are in phase with each other, right? Because obviously that's the caps on top, like so, okay? That gives you an idea of what phasing means. If that was 90 degrees out of phase, sitting, so the bearing universal joint cap was sitting on the side, it'll be 90 degrees out of phase, which would be incorrect for that, for if that was a one-piece tail shaft. Now, coming down towards the differential end, now this is probably a little bit hard to see, but you can see that that uni is actually, which should be sitting, this should be sitting level, is actually sitting crooked, right? That's the outer phasing from factory that Ford has done on these tail shafts. Now, that's just a way of curing a problem that they couldn't fix. It's sort of, I'm assuming, trying to put it in phase with the two other universal joints to try and make it work. Unfortunately, once you lift it, your operating angles increase that much that this probably works at very low operating universal joint angles, but once you lift it, it doesn't matter, even if you drop the center bearing, because it's still too much angle on this universal joint to have it out of phase. Now, you could go through and just rephase it so it isn't crooked and it's sitting the same way as that. So that cap would be how this is sitting level here. That would be sitting level, that would be in phase. It's only one spline out of phase, but it's enough to cause your vibration to get worse. But as I was going to say, if you just went through and had your tail leveled this out, like I showed you the picture, so that tail shaft was 7 degrees down, this was 7 degrees down, and you phased this, so it was in phase with this universal joint, without the one spline out of phasing, it still vibrates. I've tried it, it didn't work. It's better, but it doesn't work. Because what you're actually doing is causing this U-joint to be out of phase with that U-joint at the gearbox end. So how are we going to fix this? What we're going to do is we're going to put our car up on axle stands. Is the easiest way to go, because we're going to need to rotate the rear wheels to actually get the bolts and everything to re-line up again, the companion flange bolts to line up again once we've taken once we've rephased this tail shaft. So go ahead, put some axle stands underneath the rear axle, put the gearbox, crack the bolts loose on the actual companion flange of the differential. So you've got, and then take the gearbox out and put the gearbox into neutral so you can rotate the tail shaft assembly easily. You'll find you don't want to remove the bolts quite yet, because this will fall off. Sometimes if it's loose, if it's tight, it'll sit there, which will be fine for now. But so the next step you're going to do once you've got the bolts cracked is you're going to remove the actual dust boot clamp off the slip joint. Now, it's easier to move the one that's closest to the yoke end rather than this end. Okay, they do come off and are reusable. You just got to remember to line them back up to the same where they came off. And the other thing you might want to do while you're at this point here is put a mark to mark where this tail shaft and this the tail shaft lines up with the slip yoke. Okay, so we can get that off. I'll show you how to do that. It's pretty simple. When it's on there, you get a screwdriver in the crimp area, little fine blade screwdriver, stick it in there and then pry this open, making the crimp area expanded open. So give you an idea, put it in there, expand that open, and then with your blade screwdriver, bend the very end locking tag up so you can, so you can just get a pair of vice grips or good pliers and grip the end tag up here, pull it down and then off out of the way. You can then simply reuse it by putting this end here in a vise, gripping it in the vise by there, and then using a large blade screwdriver to expand that crimp area. And put it back on to the orientation that it came off, and then knock the little locking tag that bent down that you've bent up, and then use a pair of diagonal side cutters, if you don't have the crimpers, to crimp this shut. You can simply just put a zip tie on there too. That'll do much the same thing, because you got to remember, when you change the orientation of this, you're going to change the balance. It's only oh so slightly, right? Most of your out of balance parts are going to be if you change something along here. It still will be out of balance, but it's not going to be a vibrational issue that you're going to have to worry about as much as what it vibrates now. So once you've got that out, next trick is to slide the bottom tail shaft off the slip joint. Okay, you might want to mark it, like I said, you don't have to, and I'll show you why soon. So blade screwdriver underneath here, or a hammer, and tap that, pry that off the gear, off the differential. It actually has a spigot that it lines up in, so you'll have to compress the tail shaft slightly to do what you've got to do. And then the next thing is just to pull the tail shaft down towards the rear. So obviously this will stay sitting up here. This is still held in place by its two locating mounting bolts, I should say. I'm going to do it a bit different to the way you do it because it's apart. But basically, the tail shaft slides out of the slip yoke. And if you find it, if you rotate it, you'll see, and I've had this on both tail shafts, a yellow paint pen, and actually there's a white paint pen in that spline there to designate the manufacturer manufacturer's location for the spline or the phasing of the tail shaft. This is about one spline out of phase. So once you've got that slid all the way out, just give me a hand here. All right, so that'll still be sitting in here like that, hanging down obviously. You're going to need to then rotate this tail shaft around. So this bearing, this universal cap on this weld yoke is sitting the same as that. So straight up and down, straight up and down. That's the orientation you're going to need to get this right. Okay, and then that's, obviously this will still be in there. We'll then get this phasing right. Sorry about this, I'm trying to do this one-handed. And get that right. So that's all we've got to do is put that back into there. This is hard to do one-handed, sorry. All right. And we'll stop there just to show you that there is no master spline. This is the tail shaft end of it, the second shaft towards the differential. This is the slip joint there. As you can see, there is no master spline at all. Right, you can see the white paint pen mark. I'll turn it the right way, that'll help. That indicates the original orientation. And here is the slip yoke. Now the slip yoke does have two areas, as you can see, we'll turn it like that, 6 and 12 o'clock in this picture, that has a actual spline missing in each spot. Now this, I believe, is actually more for venting as it slides in and out. This makes it, stops it from hydraulicking as much and gives it a smoother operation rather than sort of a slipstick sort of situation. Right, that's as simple as it is. So you'll be rotating this 90 degrees from where it originally was, sort of, and then continuing as I'll continue with the video from now. All right, so I've got that back in now. Couldn't do it one-handed. So what we're aiming to do is turn this 90 degrees, this tail shaft, 90 degrees to where it was originally located. So as you can see, that U-joint cap on that weld yoke is sitting upright, and now this is sitting upright. Now, one of the things you've got to would be wise to check is get a spirit level or a finer angle gauge, and then put that there on, rotate your yoke so it's around sitting at the top. You don't have to necessarily zero it, long as the measurements are both the same. So that's 0.4 of a degree sitting there, and coming down to this weld yoke, and we're 0.2, so very close. You might have to rotate the shaft another 180 degrees from where it is, just to check to see if you can get it absolutely perfect. But if they're both sitting within 0.2, 0.3 of a degree, it's going to be changed every time I sit it on there, but you get what I'm saying. And that'll make sure that this U-joint here is in the same phase as that U-joint on the different on the gearbox. Now, once you've got that all back to slid back together, put your clamp back on and drop your tail shaft down to being both the same level. That's what we're aiming for, to have this tail shaft at, say, 7 degrees, this one at 7 degrees. I'm just going to rephrase this because you're going to treat this like a one-piece tail shaft. Right, so it's going to act like there is not a universal joint in the middle. And this is actually in the Dana Spicer book, right? That'll actually tell you to do this when you can't reduce the angle on the front shaft to less than to 1 degree on the front universal joint operating angle. So they tell you to actually phase it like this, and this works. The only thing to be concerned to worry about is the actual compound angle that I spoke about here. So the differential, if you look down there, is offset to the driver's side here in Australia, roughly about 15 mil from what I can tell, which means that you need to keep the tilted angle, the downwards angle of this second shaft and this shaft within about 0.5. So you'll end up with about 1 degree roughly overall operating angle with the compound angle included into it from what I can work out. The other thing you could go ahead and do if you want, depending on how much spaces you've got, is slot the mounting tags. So you can actually, it's around the wrong way, but so you can actually push it over to the driver's side more. So it'd be sitting like that, okay? And that will allow you to get rid of more of that compound angle. You can slot this about 5 mil, but that depends on how your tail shaft drop, how much tail shaft drop kit you've got and the size of the bolt that it actually goes through here. Hopefully that gives you an idea of what to do. If you've got any questions, and I'll drop them in the comments and I'll try and answer them. Once you've got it all slid back together and you're happy with how everything lines up, your universal joint caps are right in the same phase, don't worry about, I should have said, don't worry about putting that clip on just yet. You can drive it without it on, take it for a drive after you've bolted up your companion plans to your drive shaft. You can, before you take it off, if you like, you can actually mark it with a paint pen and mark the companion flange on the differential, just to put it back in the same place. On some vehicles, that can affect the vibration. I've noticed with mine, it makes no difference at all, because these things aren't dynamically balanced on the vehicle at all, whereas some vehicle manufacturers balance the tail shaft on the vehicle. Toyota's one of these companies that I've had where I've taken tail shafts off and ended up with a vibration and then had to rotate it around to get it in the right spot on the, if I've undone the differential, to stop it from vibrating again. I hope that video is some sort of help to you to get you a smoother running Ranger. For me, it was a lot of trial and error. I tried a lot of things, did a lot of reading. There wasn't a lot of information on the internet there about two-piece tail shafts, but I had, back from my TAFE days, a Dana Spicer or a Spicer Driveline theory book, which I dragged out again and read that to the nth degree, and it gave me a lot of help in understanding how a two-piece tail shaft should work. You know, this said, as when it comes down to tail shaft, there is no right or wrong way to have something. It's what works. You can have a look at Tom Woods. They in the US, they have a good spiel on drive shafts, and even they say for some people running, you know, one angle on a tail shaft is fine, and the same vehicle for another person is rubbish. It doesn't work. But remember, all these changes that I've showed you that you can do just by reorientating the slip yoke, you are able to put it back to the way it was, and you're not going to damage anything by taking the car for a drive to see whether it works properly or not. Right, I guess one of the things I will suggest that makes it a lot easier to understand is, like I said earlier in the video, is putting the car up on axle stands, putting it in first gear and just letting it idle over and having a look at that center bearing and how much it is actually deflecting as it rotates slowly. And that's a fair indication that you have an out of phase issue in the drive line. As you spin the drive shaft faster, that wobble in the center bearing will disappear. But it's only because it's a speed thing. Right, I'm going to include just at the end of this a video of my vehicle running up to about 90 k's an hour on axle stands, and showing you with a glass of water on the chassis rail that there is zero vibration, and this is with the double cardine joint fitted. So you know you've got an idea of where it is, and there's no nylon insert put into the tail shaft at this moment. It didn't really need it, but it just smoothed the drive shaft out a lot more than without it. So I should just add this before I run the video of my vehicle running up on the axle stands, is that if you do run the vehicle up on axle stands, you will get the ABS or fault light come on. because the front wheels aren't turning and the back wheels are. Now, unfortunately, if this comes on, it will go out after you drive for quite a while, or if you've got just a cheap scan tool, you can just clear the code when it comes up. It won't affect anything, but as I said, once you get to a certain point, you'll notice that you'll have a check engine light on, check lights on. Don't be concerned about it. As I said, you haven't wrecked anything. It's just saying that, hey, the back wheels are turning, the front ones aren't, have the sensors failed. That's all. Okay.